Hi, so I'm really pleased this week to have received a few more questions. Ashleen has asked, do fathers and mothers bring something different to the learning experience of children and why? Well, yes, because all individuals bring something different to the learning experience of children. So you're going to find that two different people may explain something in different ways. They may use different examples, put a different emphasis on things. And that is generally a good thing because you'll remember, if you've looked at the website, we talk about the importance of making links between representations. So if you've had something explained to you in two different ways and you're able to link those two different explanations together, you're likely to understand the whole concept much, much better. The only thing you have to be careful of is if mum explains it one way and dad explains it the other way, and the child can't connect the two explanations together. And that, of course, is quite possible because children's brains are still developing, and that includes the part of their brain that makes connections. So I think it's quite a good idea for mum and dad to liaise a little bit sometimes and make sure that they understand the link between the different ways in which they're explaining things. So Peter has asked, what does the research say about children listening to music while they are studying, please? Is this a good thing or not to encourage? Okay, so the first thing that springs to mind here is the so-called Mozart effect, the idea that if you put certain types of music, including Mozart, on in the background, your child is going to become more intelligent and be more able to learn. So we know that that's not true. That is a myth. However, it is true that a lot of us, including me, use background music to keep us focused on what we're doing. And the reason for that is that educational learning requires a certain level of physiological arousal. So we don't want to be falling asleep. So we need a certain amount of stimulus around us. But we don't want to be so aroused by what's happening around us that it's distracting. And therefore, you know, it can help to add a bit of extra stimulus in, and a bit of extra background music can help. I think the key thing here is, does the learner feel that it's working for them? Because different people will find different types of music distracting or not. So my teenagers seem to work better listening to rap music, which I can't understand really, because I would have thought that that would interfere with their working memory, but they seem convinced of it. And I know that I listen to music sometimes, so, you know, it is possible that it can just bring up your state of alertness so you can learn a little bit more effectively. But I would say definitely keep an eye on it. Ed asks, would offering money or financial reward help my teen to sit down and work, or is that the wrong thing to do? So there has been a study that's been done on this where teenagers were given or they were promised money in return for good GCSE grades. And the research showed that, in fact, there was no impact of offering money for academic results in terms of GCSEs, which in a way is a good thing. Maybe if you're parents, it means we don't have to be offering that sort of inducement. But we do have to provide encouragement. We do have to provide some things that are going to stimulate children's reward systems in their brain and get them engaged. And those sorts of things are novelty. And social rewards like praise and tokens acknowledging their achievement and sharing attention with others. So this stuff is on the website. But I suppose the point here is that I want to make is that the reason why it probably didn't work with the GCSEs is because it was a long-term thing. You actually have to keep yourself going for a long period of time when you're revising to do well in your GCSEs. And when we're talking about engaging the brain's reward system and that helping us to attend to our learning, we're really talking about that visceral wanting to get on with something, which is quite short-term, really. So think about short-term rewards for learning sessions for teenagers. So something that they can do later on in the day, perhaps. That's likely to be a better incentive than long-term promises of cash for grades. Ben has asked, is it true that when children of 0 to 3 years are exposed to computer screens, phones and tablets, they could become addicted to those devices? Well, this is a really interesting question and lots of people are still arguing about it. There is a small percentage of adults and children that can become, their use of technology can become so excessive that some people consider they should be said to be addicted to technology. But I think, you know, this is a very small proportion of the population. And I think the much more common thing is that children find it so engaging that it can be difficult to get them off it and onto something else. So it can create problems. I think the question to ask is, what is the child doing on the technology? If on the iPad they're doing something which is educational, that they're benefiting from, then that can be a justification for them using it. And of course, you know, with the swipe screen technology, we are talking about very young children here, so it is important to ask these questions. And I think the other really important question is, what else would the child be doing if they weren't on the technology? Because one of the most important things for a child of 0 to 3 years is their interaction face-to-face with adults who are responsive in a different way compared to a tablet. And they're learning a lot of social skills that are really foundational for their learning from those face-to-face interactions. So if they're playing with a tablet for half an hour instead of playing with a toy brick or something, I think that's fine, as long as it's not substituting for time with mum or dad or with friends. But, you know, if we're talking about hours and we're talking about just playing games on a tablet and it's substituting for time when they would actually be doing more face-to-face interaction, then it does need to be monitored and it needs to be regulated, because children do find these things incredibly engaging. And it's because of the reasons that are set out on the website in terms of how the brain responds. There's a lot of novelty in technology. There's a lot of constant rewards. And, you know, it is just very, very engaging. So I think really it's a matter of asking, what is the child doing with the tablet? And what else would they be doing? So thanks, everybody, for sending in your questions. I hope that I've been able to help in some small way. Carry on the good work. It's really important to support your children with learning at this time. And if you have any questions or queries, then please send them in. Thank you.